that contributes to the deaths of 80,000 people a year, making it the fourth leading cause of death in this country. The medical community calls it nosocomial infections. We call it the secret disease, because if you're not a doctor, you've probably never heard of it. In fact, the word nosocomial literally means the disease of being taken care of, because you get these infections while you're a patient. Hospitals are aware of the problem, and they are concerned about it. In the last decade, every accredited hospital has organized an infection control program. But patients are often unaware of the risks and the consequences of the secret disease.
This is an Eyewitness News investigation by Roberta Baskin and Seven on Your Side.
I think there was a lot to Ricky's death they didn't tell us. And I think if Ricky could have lived long enough and been able to talk to us, he could have told us a lot, too, of what happened. Because, see, nobody was with him when he got this blood, so we didn't know. We should have been there.
Ricky McPherson was only 26 years old when he died of a severe nosocomial infection. He was being treated for Hodgkin's disease, and he would drive into Chicago to receive blood transfusions as an outpatient.
He suffered an awful lot that day, and I asked him if he knew what happened, and he said part of it. But he was suffering so bad and fighting for breath that we didn't question him a whole lot.
Ricky went into a coma and died the next day of a rare blood infection. A week later, another cancer patient also died following a blood transfusion at the same hospital. The death certificate lists a blood infection as contributing to his death.
Did hospital people explain anything to you about your son's death?
I don't think there was too much explanation. They just come and told us that he couldn't live, he wouldn't live.
We showed Mrs. McPherson the confidential reports we obtained about the deaths. Investigations were conducted by both the Center for Disease Control and the hospital. The internal reports detail that both patients received blood heavily contaminated with bacteria, causing severe transfusion reactions.
I think they should have told me more about what they knew. They should have explained more to us what happened.
Both units of blood came from the Mississippi Valley Blood Center in Iowa. Dr. William Jarvis was the investigator at the Center for Disease Control.
We found that the blood was not manipulated at all in the hospital itself, but rather was received from the blood bank and administered directly to the patients.
Is there any remedy in that case?
The source of the organisms was never identified, so no changes really could be recommended.
That case was closed, but every month new cases are opened. Over a six-month period, we obtained confidential nosocomial infection reports from hospitals all over the Chicago area. These document hundreds of cases of patients with hospital infections. Some of these are minor, but others were fatal. The medical community guards these reports closely, and that means many patients are not aware of the problems. None of the hospitals would discuss the cases we found. But these documents show that the infection rates in Chicago follow the national trends. Urinary tract infections are the most common, then surgical wound infections, then respiratory infections, and finally, blood infections.
Half of these infections can be prevented by very aggressive infection surveillance and control activities in these hospitals.
The Center for Disease Control is the federal network that provides hospitals with information and advice about nosocomial infections. But they also recognize that that information does not often filter down to the patient.
It's surprising how rarely a nosocomial infection results in a malpractice claim.
I think
that's because the public has generally has the view that infections that occur in the hospital are the logical consequence of their illness. And so when it actually results from poor technique or some fault of a hospital employee, it may not be as apparent to them.
Hospital staff, and particularly the physicians, don't want to talk about it. They don't want to tell the patient, well, you got surgery 2 weeks ago or a week ago, and today you've got a surgical wound infection. They talk about, well, it's your wound's draining a little bit. We'll take care of it, don't worry about it. They tend to minimize that sort of problem because I think they're embarrassed about it. They don't like to recognize that, yes, this has happened to me.
It does happen to some 2 million patients a year who come into a hospital and develop hospital-acquired infections. In a moment, we'll meet two people who had simple surgery and afterwards developed life-threatening infections. And we'll also show you the problems we found in Chicago area hospitals. Doctors and hospitals are aware that hospital-acquired infections are an ever-present problem, but the source of many of these infections can be puzzling. In fact, it's only recently that doctors have learned that one kind of infection developed after surgery can lead to a disease known as toxic shock syndrome.
Okay, I was in the hospital for 2 months, 2 days, and it was like a month of my life I don't remember. It's like I totally lost. I really don't know.
It was just a traumatic shock to us, you know, that what was supposed to be a simple knee surgery, but she was only supposed to be in the hospital for 3 days. On the third day, they were going to release her. Then she started coming down with the high fever, the rash. Her body swelled.
Jean went into a coma for a month after routine surgery to remove some cartilage from her knee. She gained 60 pounds in a week. The knee became infected, and Jean ended up fighting for her life. She has some permanent reminders of the ordeal. The scar from the emergency tracheostomy, puncture marks from intravenous monitoring devices, and a badly disfigured knee.
It didn't really hit me at first, and then when it hit me, I felt, you know, wow, I went through that. I almost died.
William McCaslin says he's still suffering from the effects of his knee surgery.
It was delirious. I didn't know, I can't even read. Recall much of what happened while I was in the hospital for those days.
Both patients came here to St. Anthony's Hospital in Rockford. They each had knee surgery on the same day in the same operating room, one after another. Then they were each hospitalized in adjacent rooms. Dr. Mark Moyer investigated the cases. He says both patients came down with toxic shock syndrome, a disease now linked to post-operative wound infections.
The young girl was incredibly sick. I mean, you cannot be any sicker and still pull through. The problem with toxic shock syndrome is that the disease is caused by a toxin that's released by the bacteria and not so much the bacteria themselves. Antibiotics have no effect on the toxin once it's released by the bacteria.
Mr. McCaslin and his wife say that their own doctors kept them uninformed.
I don't want to alarm you in any way, but have you ever heard of toxic shock syndrome?
No.
Toxic shock syndrome is actually what you had.
No.
Nobody ever told you that you had toxic shock syndrome?
No. The problem is hospitals are breeding grounds for bacteria. And toxic shock syndrome is only one of a number of diseases caused by harmful microorganisms. The medical authorities say half of these infections could be avoided by reducing the spread of germs. And experts agree that the simple act of washing hands is the best defense.
We know of a number of many outbreaks of infection or epidemics in hospitals that result from patient-to-patient transfer of very virulent bacteria or viruses that get a ride from one patient to another on the unwashed hands of personnel.
Seven on Your Side investigated the problems at Chicago area hospitals. We took with us a nationally recognized infection control expert and a city health inspector. We followed a nurse as she went from patient to patient without hand washing. The Center for Disease Control says that is not acceptable practice.
I didn't hear any water running. I didn't see any evidence of hand washing going on.
In a nursery, we saw a nurse go from one baby to another without washing her hands. This is especially critical because newborns are so susceptible to infection. Another high-risk group is kidney dialysis patients. We saw nurses touch patients during treatments without washing their hands first. We even found improper hand washing prior to surgery. All jewelry is supposed to be removed. To see what germs your hands might have in a hospital, I had a culture made of my hand before washing.
This one looks much like a streptococcus.
Is this disease producing?
Could be.
Could cause what, a sore throat?
Sore throat.
After washing my hands with soap and water, the strep germs were gone. In one surgery recovery area, the only sink for hand washing was in a separate utility room, isolated from the patient care area.
The hand washing facility was there right next to the hopper where they would empty bedpans and so on. So that's not acceptable practice.
In a laundry area, clean linen was dragged on the floor.
Hospital linen is grossly contaminated. It has a tremendous amount of contamination from the patient's organisms that come off the beds and so on. And if it's not contained and properly handled and transported and so on, you can indeed disseminate a tremendous amount of microbial contamination around.
In a recovery unit, we inspected sterile trays of equipment for emergency use. This is how they should be wrapped, but we found some improperly packaged. These sterile items were also not labeled correctly to show when they are outdated.
We're hoping that they'll order up another one and return this immediately. This should not even go back on the cart.
Surgery is an important infection control area because a surgical patient runs a risk of getting an infection three times greater than a non-surgical patient. The federal government says hair must be completely covered to protect the patient from being contaminated by scalp bacteria. We found the ceilings in some operating rooms perforated. That's not acceptable. Ceilings are supposed to be solid so that dust and debris does not sift down into an open wound. A hospital can lower its surgical wound infections dramatically with improved cleaning and surveillance.
You do have to be very tough. It's a matter of getting round and supervising and ensuring that the work is done properly and that there is no slipshod areas whatsoever.
In an intensive care unit where patients are highly susceptible to infection, we found carpeted areas. Again, the Center for Disease Control objects because rugs trap bacteria and are difficult to clean. These are only a few of the problems that make a hospital a combat zone of microorganisms.
The hospital is probably the least safe place to be when you're sick. Hospitals have a concentration of bacteria and viruses that can cause disease, and they also have a concentration of sick people. So when you put those two things together, you will, of necessity, have a dangerous situation.
Your risk of getting a hospital-acquired infection depends on many things: how old you are, how sick you are, even the type of hospital you're treated in. Coming up, we'll look at more on the risks and their costs. Hospital-acquired infections are a problem at all hospitals, and according to the Center for Disease Control, some infection problems inside hospitals cannot be avoided, while others can be prevented by simple precautions. At stake are huge costs in patient lives and dollars.
You come out with somewhere in the range of $2 billion per year, extra costs added to patients' hospital bills to treat their nosocomial infections, infections they didn't come in the hospital with.
On the average, a blood infection adds 10 days and $1,000. Nosocomial pneumonia, 7 days and $1,300. A surgical wound infection adds 7 days and $800. And a urinary tract infection, the most common problem, adds a day and $200. The Center for Disease Control is monitoring hundreds of hospitals around the country to analyze their infection problems. After 8 years of study, the results are expected to show that hospitals can significantly reduce their nosocomial infections. According to the center, the most important way to reduce hospital-acquired infections is by simple hand washing. A lab technician demonstrated by culturing her hand, then washing and culturing again. The results clearly show a handprint of live bacteria before washing, but only a few scattered colonies of bacteria after washing. In a hospital environment where there's literally billions of bacteria, it's easy for disease-producing bugs to be transferred from one sick patient to another with a touch of a hand.
Bacteria don't walk by themselves. They have to get from one place to the other, either on a piece of clothing or a dressing or on someone's hands. They're not going to pick up themselves and go.
Millions of dollars worth of antibiotics are produced every year to combat infections. But as soon as the companies develop a new drug, the bacteria can build up resistance.
Certainly, if you compare the early 50s to the early 80s, there's been a dramatic increase in the number of organisms that are resistant to antibiotics. And as we introduce new antibiotics, it's just a matter of time before you see organisms developing resistance to it.
One way hospitals have learned to control bacteria is by sterilizing equipment. However, that process can be time-consuming. So instead, many hospitals only disinfect certain equipment like respirators, which are linked to hospital-acquired pneumonia. The CDC ideally recommends sterilization because disinfection is not as thorough.
Tend to cut corners sometimes, and we find that hospitals are caught in conflicting pressures between the need to save money and keep costs down and the need to have programs that are effective for preventing infections.
And the result of that can mean that more patients will get nosocomial infections.
Yes, very definitely.
The most common problem area of all is the urinary catheter. Depending on the type of catheter and its handling, nosocomial urinary tract infections can be dramatically reduced. The CDC recommends that a catheter not stay in any longer than necessary.
We try to teach nurses to not use catheters for nursing convenience, but for necessity for the patient. Sometimes they stay in too long because no one has asked the question, can this catheter come out of this patient?
As much as hospitals try to reduce their infection problems, CDC experts also recommend that patients themselves try and avoid the risks.
A knowledgeable patient is their own best protection against getting any type of infection, and that you should know what disease or illness you have and what the risks and the problems are with that illness.
The type of hospital you are admitted to also plays a role in your infection risks. CDC studies reveal that generally, city hospitals have the highest nosocomial infection rates. University hospitals have fewer problems, and community hospitals have the lowest infection rates of all.
Patients should always be aware of potential problems and hazards within the institution they are becoming hospitalized in. There needs to be a greater appreciation that bacteria, even though they're not visible, can create severe problems in patients. And these problems may result in increased hospital stay, increased hospital costs, increased illness, as well as increased death rates.
Over the last 10 years, controlling hospital-acquired infections has developed into an entire field of medicine. Coming up, we'll look at what the experts are doing about the problems to fight back. Some of what you've seen here tonight has caused a great deal of controversy and criticism in the medical community. Critics have said this is not a subject for television and that the story should focus on how much hospitals are doing about infection control. Others feel that it's good for patients to be more aware of the risks of hospital-acquired infections. Certainly, the secret disease is no secret to the two physicians with me here in the studio. Dr. Lee Adler is an infection control consultant and teacher. Dr. Burton Anderson is also an infectious disease expert at a Chicago hospital. They each have different views on this subject. Dr. Anderson, what are hospitals doing about infection control?
Well, I'd like to make it clear that hospitals in general, physicians working in hospitals and hospital administrators are very aware of the problem of hospital-acquired infections. And there are a number of mechanisms that are in place for dealing with these problems. The major systematic method for dealing with this is the Hospital Infections Control Committee. All hospitals have these committees. They're required to have the committees. And they deal with two aspects of the problem, prevention and early detection of a problem should it develop in a hospital.
I agree with you that we are putting mechanisms in place, but there's a variability between hospitals that exists. Not all hospitals have infectious disease people to run the infection control committee. I believe that the public, when they go to a medical care facility, deserve the lowest risk possible, and this should be demanded by the public from the hospital administration. This type of public pressure placed on the hospital administrators will increase their support of infection control programs.
I do think that it's a good idea for a general public awareness that there is such a problem. I'm a little concerned that there could be so much awareness and fear that some patients might be afraid to come in the hospital because of such problems. I think it should be recognized that that with new developments in the treatment of many diseases, cancer in particular, We've prolonged the life of many patients.
So what you're saying is that hospitals are prolonging the life of patients with new procedures, but those procedures can also make the patient more vulnerable to
an
infection.
This is, I think, a price that we have to pay. We certainly try to control those infections to as great an extent as possible, but there is absolutely no way that we can provide an absolutely sterile environment in a hospital. You can't sterilize a human being, neither the patient nor the hospital staff. And those organisms will always be in the hospital to a certain extent. But I think there's another thing that should be recognized, and that is that the degree of the problem varies from one hospital to another. I don't feel that you can have an across-the-board system that applies to all hospitals in all kinds of situations. I think that's impractical and terribly expensive.
What role does money play, very, very briefly?
Well, I believe it, up front, it takes money to hire effective infection control personnel. It's the responsibility of the hospitals to assure that these quality individuals are present, and I think the public should ask the physicians and the hospitals whether their infection control programs are being run by specially trained individuals. If a hospital reduces by 6% its infection rate, they have paid for the infection control program.
I think it's impossible to totally eliminate the problem. I think it's important, really, for the public to be aware that there is an awareness among the medical profession that there is a serious problem, but that we're dealing with it. And you could argue, you know, should we spend more money on this problem for more education? Since my interest is in that area, I would have to agree, yes, there should be more money spent. There is room for improvement, but a great deal is being done.
I want to thank you both for sharing your views with us tonight. Last week, Chicago's Department of Health convened a special advisory committee of healthcare experts to study the problem and make some recommendations. In the meantime, if you have to go to a hospital, you can ask questions about the hospital's infection control practices. It's your health. It should never be a secret. For 7 on Your Side, I'm Roberta Baskin. Thanks for joining us tonight.